Thank you very much. Give me 2 more minutes for this interruption. So the desertification, according to the United Nations, is refers to land degradation, particularly in arid, semi-arid, and sub-humid areas of the world, including Nigeria. Now, technology.
You just have to push the arrow.
Right. As part of the introduction, the purpose of this paper is to show the extent of desertification and land degradation in Nigeria due to unsustainable environmental practices, agriculture, and some other activities, human activities, and the effects of this on the livelihoods of the people. It is indeed a summation presentation. I didn't do all the work. In fact, the part of the work I did is not even included here, because as a summation, you just take the poignant parts and present. And indeed, the summation is an effort of various agencies, including our own, at the Center for Arizona Studies of University of Maiduguri, on study trials on community acceptance and adoption of fabricated energy-saving cooking stoves and sub-regional level as part of the mitigation of desertification in Nigeria. The presentation includes the most recent and very ambitious proposal, the Great Green Wall Sahara Sahel Initiative, that is trying to build a huge green wall across the Sahel of West Africa. Now, desertification in the front lines of frontline states of Nigeria, the threatened 11 states, we shall show you later, is a group of states that is bordering Niger Republic and constitute 40% of landmass of the country. 40% is no joke. It's, if it is a fertile land, that is really a big chunk of a country that is threatened. Consequently, agricultural production has expanded 17%. Gully erosion increased by 16% in 15 years since 1976. Sand dune formation increased 17%. Significant decline in mean annual rainfall amounting to 11 millimeter per year, but not because of general decrease, but because of decrease in days of rain, particularly in August. That is the highest rain month in the year. Over 30 years of decrease in Lake Chad water, the surface now from 25,000 kilometers square, it is less than 3,000 square meters. In fact, if there is any water at all in the lake. So it's the environmental, now this is Sahel of Africa, showing delineation of 200 millimeter to 800 millimeter rainfall, which is really the Sahel. Now, Sahel in West Africa, Sahel in East Africa, Sahel in South Africa. Now, desertification frontline states of Nigeria, this part of Nigeria, bordering Niger Republic, is the most threatened region of the country. At the same time, this portion of Nigeria, which is called transition states of Nigeria, is really a group of states, I shall name them later, that are overexposed in terms of migration from people from the north, migration of livestock from the north, because this area is the most agriculturally productive area of Nigeria. Now, the frontline states, Bauchi, Gombe, Kano, Yobe, which others? Katsina, Sokoto, Zamfara, Kebbi, and Adamawa. These are the threatened states. Now, you will note that the most population pressure state is Kano. We shall refer back to that. Visible impacts of desertification, drought, and climate change. Gradual shift in the vegetation from grasses, scrublands, and trees to areas that are expansively sand, desert-like. Decline in forest cover, decline in agricultural lands, decreasing rainfall, receding lake channel. These are all signs of increasing desertification. Now, this is a study by an agency called Formeku. You could see the status of Nigeria's vegetation cover in 1976/1978 compared in 1993 and 1995, about 33% of land cover is gone because of desertification. Forest cover, there is no forest cover really. The United Nations says 25% of any country should be allowed to be forested. But in this case, 10% will be overconfidence, and I would even say 3%, because of population pressure, particularly in Nigeria. Land use in agriculture, you could see in 1976, 78, compared with 1993-95, substantial land is being used now to compensate for the loss in agricultural land. Now, rain, I said, in decreasing rainfall, not increasing. Since 1966, we have never come up to normal rainfall. This is serious. And the six sites that agree, the recordings at the six sites agree with what we have shown. Lake Chad, we made a comment, but Lake Chad, according to Dunham, this great German explorer from Tripoli to Yola three times, he described Lake Chad as a great inland sea. And 1964, you could still have good water. You can even use a speedboat on Lake Chad. But as of 2001, even some countries do not have water in the part of the lake in their country. For example, Cameroon and Chad had some good water. But Niger and Nigeria, only grass and weeds. Now, methodology, it's very difficult to present methodology in this kind of presentation, where you are making assumption. But it is true that specific methods may be cited for particular projects mentioned as appropriate. It is, however, noted that the environmental impact assessment or community reconnaissance and needs assessment, these are more important. We have done that. And of course, in the rural areas, mostly people will say, ah, come and do agricultural improvement for us. That to them is more important. But then you listen to them, you are friendly, and then you bring them in to say, no, that is not exactly what we want. We want agriculture, yes, but we must expand it to other activities. This is what we have done. And by and large, was very successful. Now, efforts in desertification management, this really is the paper. Many national and international agencies such as EU, World Bank, British Council, USAID, and many others have participated in under-desertification, either going into the field or by manpower development. Now, efforts in colonial era, in that time before 1960, the colonial people were wise enough to allow the regional government to take over forestry matters, except, of course, research. Now, by 1977-80, however, the focus had shifted. We now wanted to have large-scale monoculture plantations of exotic trees, for example, neem, and for afforestation projects, tree planting campaigns, and shelter belt development that is roll back the desert. And in 1980s, the 11 frontline states, they were not 11 at that time. You know, you will keep on creating states until I don't know how many we will have in a few years. They constituted a committee that went out and checked what is the state of desertification in northern Nigeria. We must do it ourselves. That committee went out and submitted their report in 1989. They reported as critical areas, that is zone one, highly affected by desertification to a point of 48,000, the area that I showed you before. The 48% of those states, the 48% of the landmass of those states were adversely affected as average. But those states that extended to above latitude 12 degrees, the amount of desertification was much, much, much higher, 75% desertified. The less critical zone, zone two, that is the buffer states. The buffer states, as we stated, are very important. They were desertified 25%. Partially deforested, or this is all over the states. Deforestation was going on at a very rapid rate. Special degraded areas, well, that is also right of way. When you have a right of way, nobody, the government just takes over and does whatever it wants. And for example, if you go to Abuja's capital of Nigeria today, the level of the, deforestation is incredible. That also contributes to desertification. In 1980s, Kano, Sokoto, Katsina, and one or two other states, in collaboration with the federal government, developed fantastic shelter belts. And we shall show you that later. Now, work of Forest Management Evaluation Coordinating Unit, FORMECU, very important. FORMECU played a critical role in conducting an inventory of natural forests and plantation in the country. And also, at the same time, made some recommendations, for example, in terms of the National Forestry Action Program, use that to then get to the people, to get the people come and help in terms of forestry management. But more importantly than that, the work of FORMECU, as you have seen in subsequent and previous figures, provided critical evidence on the serious vegetation changes and biodiversity loss in the country for warning of the problems of desertification. FORMECU was the first to tell Nigeria, look, the population is increasing, the level of destruction of forests is too much. The Great Green Wall of Sahara Sahel initiative, perhaps we should have spent more time on that. The African heads and government in 2007 endorsed GGWSSI with the main objective to tackle the detrimental economic and environmental impacts on land degradation and desertification in 11 Sahara countries. It's amazing that 11, these 11 states, they are listed down here. I think Sudan is included. Yes, Sudan is included. Across the whole, I wish we could go back to that Sahel of Africa. Now, the main objective, to support the efforts of local communities in the sustainable management and use of natural resources, to contribute to the climate change mitigation and improve food security of the Sahelian people, and more importantly, to strengthen the resilience of the Sahelian people for sound ecosystem management, sustainable development, and land resources, and protection of rural heritage with improved living conditions. These are very, very powerful objectives. In Nigeria, however, Nigeria signed the Memorandum of Understanding for GGWSSI in 2013 and immediately started implementation. In Nigeria, GGWSSI is largely community-based. This is good news, because we don't bring the local people into projects or programs that is their own livelihoods. All the frontline states of Nigeria would involve about 46 local governments to develop a contiguous shelter belt from Kebbi to Borno State, my own state. Well, you are not too familiar with Nigeria's map, but we'll see it. Now, this is a distance of more than 1,500 kilometers long and 15 kilometers wide. In fact, 3/10 of the total distance of the Africa GGWSSI of 775 kilometers from Dakar to Djibouti. The communities will be supervised to raise 60 million drought-resistant trees, seedlings, for establishment and also sustenance of the shelter belt. This is community-based development. From Dakar to Djibouti, if that can be done, I think Africa has contributed immensely to anti-desertification. Now in Nigeria, we were not idle. This shelter belt, 1 kilometer of belts, many of them in lines, and this basically is neem. But if you have this neem, and then you interspaced with medium-sized trees such as gamarabi, then you have very big protection belt. Strategic desertification control, sand dune stabilization, sand dunes now in northern Nigeria, all over the place. Mechanical mulching, biological techniques for sand dune stabilization are very reliable. After the dunes had been stabilized, the biological aspect is much better. You then use very, very fast-growing trees, and such as Prospis viliflora. And these trees can grow anywhere. In fact, these trees are pests. They are weeds. And if you are not careful, if you expose your farm too much to them, in due course, they will take over and chase the farmer away. The recent large-scale commercial farming of Jatropha is good news, because that will mean the farmer is stabilizing his farm soils. This is a sand dune in Yobe State, one of the northern states, and no local government can contain this. This is another desertification in process in Tulutuluwa and Kaska in Yobe State. Note that somebody is watching the direction of wind and how much sand is deposited per hour. These trees, never seen hardy trees like this. Other vegetations would have died. But Balanitis aegyptica is a tree that will last for 100 years, even if the roots down there have been dug up by the desert winds. So we want to have agronomy of this tree, except that local comments, you have to be careful with the sociological aspects of how you develop these plants. Now, this beautiful oasis, you see sand dune coming from the other side, you see this one from this side. If care is not taken, it will disappear in no time. This is Damasak in Borno State. Note the electric wire. Where there is electric wire, there is a major road. Now, this road, if care is not taken, this dune is moving southwards, will block this road, preventing Damasak from communication with vehicular communication with Maiduguri. In closing remarks, the outstanding environmental threat is the southward spread of desertification, estimated at 0.6 kilometers per year in northern part of the country. A major constraint, as my colleague has mentioned, decreasing rainfall and water resources in the area. In addition to other human population pressures, the major ones that we must watch, agricultural practices, deforestation, and livestock farming. After all, livestock, cows, desert, you know, the Egyptian desert. It was cows that created that desert. So we have to watch that. Now, in conclusion, finally, desertification and environmental insecurity are accelerating in Nigeria's Sahel, where intersection of hotspots leads to tenuous livelihoods. We read about Boko Haram as part of the problem. The impact of desertification on the ecosystem and livelihoods of the people in the frontline states is enormous and poverty generating. GGWSSI in Nigeria is a program that is so important that it has to be given special attention and acceptance by all concerned. And indeed, communities must contribute and accept this project. Monitoring, evaluation, and coordinating assessment must be enhanced. And Formico should repeat the 1976-1978 Vegetation Environmental Survey in 2010 and 2012 soonest. Again, federal government with partners international. In Adopt in Abuja, I met him and I congratulated him because he is now the chairman of the 11 desertification threatened states of Nigeria. The governors of the 11 threatened states, he is the chairman. So I gave him a copy of this paper. He was very happy. He said, go and come back. Maybe if I discuss with him and he can manage to get more money, we may invite you on not desertification alone, but sustainability and other developmental proposals. Thank you very much.
My name is Amal. I'm from Sudan. In Sudan, we're suffering the same problem of desertification. So I'm interested in this topic. I would like to ask you, you mentioned that you did the inventory for all the flora and the vegetation of your country. I'm asking how did you do this inventory? You survey all the country and you classify the desert land into critical areas and semi-critical areas, and you calculate all the species you found. For example, you mentioned Balanitis aegyptica. This species also we have in Sudan in semi-arid and savanna regions. But in semi-arid regions, we have still some species and we calculated. in some small researches. You did this for all the country because you have some organization help you in this for the country. We introduce also Jatropha from the family for BAC, and we use it to stop desertification in the semi-arid regions in Khartoum, west of Khartoum. We have the belt of this planetic Giptiaga from West Africa to the East Africa, and it declined and degraded the vegetation of this area, degraded, and we noticed that most of the vegetation or the species are not found today in our inventory. Also, I would like to ask when you divided this land, you depend on the amount or the content of rainfall, or you depend on the vegetation cover you found in this area, the percentage, and then you divide it into these. Thank you. I can hear the answer. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for your comments, as mentioning the similarities between some of the species in the Republic of Sudan and the Federal Republic of Nigeria. The similarities are not only in plants. When I visited Sudan sometime, long time ago, I was amazed at the similarities between Borno and similarities between Borno State and Sudan. And actually, even your music is loved so much in Borno. It's amazing, the social affinities of our part of the world. What we'd like to see is that this GGWSSI, I hope, will bring us together closer. I hope the viability and sustainability will be real. I hope that the people will own not only the plants, but the whole project itself. But truly, the Jatropha thing is a very popular thing now. In fact, I wanted to discuss this with you later. The farmers in the Sahel area of Nigeria are very the lady of innovation. They are very innovative people. And I don't know where they heard that that plant is diesel producing seeds. So now in Katsina, for example, huge farms are being developed with plantation of that species. I hope we'll be able to exchange notes. We'll be able to, part of the support, I couldn't present it here, but part of the support is how can biotechnology, even if we are suspicious of the food aspect, can't we use it as plants that are studied as enhanced because of biotechnological means? Can't we use it to stabilize our environment? This is going on. In fact, in my biotechnology center of University of Maiduguri, we have enhanced the capacity of that. And studies on these plants now is the main priority of that center. And thank you again for your comments. But I hope we will be in touch to exchange information. And this, really, this center, this conference is a key conference for all of us who are trying to develop. Thank you.
Professor, for your interesting and knowledgeable presentation. I have just a little remark. I want to know. They say that Jatropha, we are using Jatropha in our in a lot of state, Northern Omdurman, and they have grown it for a large area. But recently, they say that Jatropha diminished the soil from its minerals. If that's true, we are using it in a lot of researches, even the microorganisms, even as a natural alternative to pesticides. We have tried these. But recently they say that they diminish the soil from its minerals. Although it's a biodiesel plant. Is this true?
Well, studies on Jatropha is not very extensive. I think this gives us an opportunity to share information. Unless you have done at least 10 years of continuous growth of Jatropha studying, we take soil studies in Nigeria very seriously. And then you check the status of your soil over that period. I wouldn't jump to conclusion too early. In any case, how do you manage these soils? We have had very interesting presentations on soil and effect of growth of some crops in this conference. Very, very interesting. Now, you have to look at combinations. You have to look at alternatives. You have to give large enough try to be able to come to that conclusion. I wouldn't take this as the final statement. I will put it in question mark.
What you are suggesting, the type of this particular variety is not competing with the cropland. It's more on a marginal land.
Yeah.
Marginal land.
That's right.
So the land use, I don't think was going to be that major issue.
Yes.
But the issue, I suppose, which also some scientists, because biology was the major issue here, but what they're trying to say was perhaps whether it has some capacity to destroy crops in long sort of distance areas or something like that. Thank you.
Yeah, well, anyway, much of the land, you can't grow anything on much of the land anyway. I thought how to improve the portion that you are going to use as agricultural land is more important than condemning Jatropha for stabilizing the generality of the environment. Yes.